Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Divide and Conquer as we are continuing with the faction overviews with today, the Dwarves of Kazakh Doom. So, but going straight into the overview, you will notice that things are a little bit different today, because we are starting at the first turn instead of the second turn, which I normally do to include the auto-expansion of every faction. But today we won't, because Kazakh Doom is different from a lot of other factions, since it's a horde faction. So you don't start with any settlement, and the first part of your campaign is all scripted with the reclamation of Kazakh Doom by High Lord Balin. So it will be a short first part of the video, and the majority of the video will be the show off of Kazakh Doom's units. So without further ado, let's just dive in immediately into the script. And it works two ways. So the first part is all of the script is for always the same. You get the opportunity to actually train a lot of troops in here. But do note, you only have 1,000 gold. And there's nothing incoming for now. So you have a small starting opportunity. You can choose to take some infantry or one unit of horses, I think. Yes. You will have to make a choice. I would personally go for the cavalry, since all dwarves really lack the cavalry. But the choice is up to you. But the first part, you have to move Lord Balin towards Dale, and from there on, the script actually starts. It gives you a choice to take one of the two paths towards Kazakh Doom. The first part is straight as possible, which make you go down the river through the forest, I think through here, and then cross at Beorn's Halls towards and then down the mountains. And the other road is up north here, avoiding the forest, down south the river, and also crossing at Beorn's Halls. The huge difference between the two parts is the northern part is longer, but is safe. If you go down south, the straight route, you will be attacked in the forest, I think a couple of times, two or three times, by Dúl Guldur, which can cause some casualties, and we'll make sure that you have less troops when you reach Kazakh Doom, but you are there quicker, so the goblins won't be able to mass the troops as much as they will when you take the path north. But the path north is safer, you will not be attacked, you will have the opportunity to participate in a couple of battles. I think one of them is up here on the slopes of the Grey Mountains, one is at Beorn's Halls, and there might be one here somewhere in the Gladden Fields, but I'm not sure about the last one. That you have the choice to participate. If you decide to participate, you will fight the battle, but you will be rewarded. So I think it is once said that your troops will be healed. I don't think that is the case. I think they will have you will have the casualties, but you will be rewarded with additional troops. So I think at the slopes of the Grey Mountains, you will be rewarded with some dwarven laborers. When you participate in Beorn's Halls, you will be rewarded with Bjorning Axemen. And I think, because I'm not sure, there is a bell over here, because I can't remember what you would receive over here. So I don't think there is any bell further from down Beorn's Hall. It's just straight toward Khazad Dûm and siege the city. So the northern route might provide you with some more troops when you actually arrived, but you will arrive later, so the city of Khazad Dûm might be fortified more, while the route down south is quicker, but you will be attacked by Dûl Guldur. And I think there is, the first one is pretty easy, and the second one is, I think they're all in the, on this road, which is called the Old Forest Road. I think they're all here. The first is straightforward, a couple of Dûl Guldur hosts, Dûl Guldur scouts load here. And the second contains trolls, if I remember well. There might be a third, but I'm not really sure about it. So it will build up in difficulty. Alright, and then when you arrive at Khazad Dûm and you are able to take it, it turns out mostly as a normal campaign. There are some ends towards ends with the script. For example, Balin's coronation, which is a nice thing to touch upon, because as far as I'm aware of, and I have look through the changelog and I couldn't find a change in it. Before the coronation of Balin, you're asked to send a diplomat towards Bri to get the help of Gandalf. If you decide to do so, the army that attacked at Balin's coronation will not contain a Balrog. If you decide not to send a diplomat, it will. So it can make a huge difference in the outcome of the battle. Then dealing with the victory conditions. They haven't changed it. So you have to hold 30 regions, including Khazad Dûm, Khazad Dûm West, and Dunlarak, and Mount Gundabad. So, pretty much the mountains. Gundabad is your ancient, it's like a sacred place for you, because that is where, what's his name? The first dwarf awakened. I now just forgot the name. Can look it up, but not now. So that is where, and that is what your victory conditions are. The terrain slightly different with version 4.5, because Dunland received this end of the province that once belonged to Khazad Dûm West. So everything down the river is don't belong any longer to you, which makes sense, because the river is kind of a natural border. So that is what is different from version 4.5. Do I need to mention some things? Yes, I think it's nice to touch upon that once you have reclaimed Khazad Dûm, where you have Oin and Ori, who will become characters instead of retinue. Oin will become a general and your faction heir, and Ori will become a diplomat. So that's a nice thing. You see that everything is restricted, so you need to follow the script, and if you have made a decision to go either south or north, only the areas that you are allowed to go by your choice will be opened up. So if you have made a choice to go down south, think, oh, this is too hard, I go back and go north, that's not a possibility. You made your choice and you have to live with it. Or you need to start over the campaign. That's your choice. Once you have claimed Khazad Dûm, you will be asked to send a diplomat to both Erebor and Ered Luwin. If you do so, you will receive some troops, and you will receive the opportunity to build the Hall of the Seven, which gives you access to troops of all seven dwarf clans. So Orkhani, Erebor, and some Ered Luwin troops, which is a nice addition to your already pretty nice roster. I think there are some what's it called? Ered Luwin scouts, the crossbowmen. I think they are one of the units you will get access to, which is nice since the dwarven archers are not that great for Khazad Dûm, although they are better than for Erebor. Especially the beastmasters are pretty nice, if I remember well. But we'll see them in a moment. So overall, the majority of Khazad Dûm's campaign is the beginning script. It's what makes the campaign different from other campaigns, and I think it's really nice. It all focuses really on the quest of Balin, and I really like it, because how sad the story is in the books, being able to roleplay it and make a difference, I really enjoy. So this is all I had to say about the campaign map, because there is not that much to say about it. Because buildings are like equal to the dwarves of Erebor. There's no much difference in there. That is everything for the campaign map, and I will see you on the battle map. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the battle map of Khazad Dûm. So, let's dive in. Without further ado, on the first glance, we see the lack of cavalry. There is no cavalry for Khazad Dûm. So, you need to rely on mercenary for cavalry. Second is that we have a huge infantry choice, and also our archery is limited. Of these two units, one is a mercenary, the Dwarven Travelers. So you only have one unit you can train yourself. The Hittaglir Beast Hunters. Also, cavalry-wise, archery-wise, you are limited and do mostly need to rely on either your siege equipment, the Orkhani Hall, who provides with Blacklock Engineers. And they don't provide with the Ered Luwin crossbows. I've checked that. You don't get Ered Luwin crossbows, but you get the Blacklock Engineers, which is a crossbow unit as well. And I think Stiffbit Archers is standard for the Orkhani. So you might get them. Besides that, you'd need to rely on the Dwarven Travelers for your archers. But let's first start with the lowest tier, your kind of trash tier, the Dwarven Laborers. But for trash tier, it's a really good unit, because let's be honest, 4 attack, 2 charge, and a 9 defense is something other nations would be jealous of for a trash tier unit. And if that isn't enough, your 4 attack is also armor piercing, because they have this kind of pickaxes things, and I'm There are some hammers in here, but I think it are just pickaxes. So, an armor-piercing trash tier unit is really good, actually. Already set at a 4 attack, 2 charge, 9 defense. Do note they don't have shields, so they are vulnerable to archer fire. Especially with the movement penalty of 5%, so they are slightly slower than other infantry. They do have a good morale and average morale response since they are dwarves, and dwarves are better have a better morale in battles in general. So they are more warlike than other nations. So one unit in a trash tier and a pretty good unit as well. Then moving up to your militia tier units, the Kazakh units. With a 7 attack, a 4 charge, and a 14 defense, they are way better than the laborers. And we're starting with the Kazakh volunteers, I forgot to mention. And just a regular sword and board unit, with a very good morale, an average morale response, and also dwarves, the 5% penalty. I'm saying it for the second time, I will not say it throughout the whole overview, 5% penalty for the dwarves. Just a good sword and board unit. And whilst these guys can flank the enemy, these guys can hold them. The Kazakh sentries. With a 4 attack, a 4 charge, and a 70 defense. They are slightly less aggressive. But they have a better defense. They're skilled against mounts since they are spears. They have a very good morale. Average morale response. And since they are spears and bonus fighting against camels, walks, horses, and elephants. Then I will also deal with the dwarven travelers, because they are kind of same tier, and I have even now I have slots open, but there are no units I think were worth mentioning who weren't already mentioned somewhere else. So dwarven travelers, 5 attack, 3 missile attack, 3 charge and a 10 defense. Very good morale, average morale response, 24 missiles, 150 meter range, and an average accuracy, making them reliable archers. And I've seen that when they are done, they are pretty good melee fighters as well. Now we will move over, because, well, in this kind of tier, you also get access to the Dwarven Ballistae. There's nothing really special for ballistas, although I don't think normal ballistas are armor piercing. Could be wrong about that. The difference between dwarven ballistas and normal ballistas is that they have a better accuracy. So dwarven siege equipment will hit things are more likely to hit things compared to other nations. Siege equipment. Then, going up to your mainstream units, we get the Legion units. And we start with the most right one, the Legion Dipping Guard. A sword and board unit, 8 attack, 4 charge, and a 23 defense. And you already see that this is where the dwarves shine in high defense stats with good armor. 23 defense for a mainstream unit is really, really good, actually. Most nations get these numbers at their elite, so really, really good unit. Excellent morale, good morale response. They are even slower than other dwarves, so they have a 10% movement penalty compared to other normal infantry, non-dwarven infantry. Then we're dealing with the more defensive variant of them, the Legion Shield Guard. With a 5 attack, 4 charge, and a 26 defense, they have a higher defense but a lower offense, making them a better unit to hold the line while others flank in and deal the damage. Again, excellent morale, good morale response, but they don't have They are skilled against mount, but they don't have the extra trait that they have a bonus against mounts. Which is odd, actually, because they are just a regular spear unit. Then, dealing with the more offensive variant of the Deeping Guard, the Legion Hammer Guard. With an 8 attack, a 6 charge, and a 20 defense, you see right away their charge is higher, but they repay that with their defense. They are armor piercing though, so overall their attack is also higher. They have excellent morale, good morale response, just a good charge unit. Then we deal with your only unit, the only archer unit you can train yourself, the Hittaeglir Beast Hunters. And with a 9 attack, a 5 missile attack, a 7 charge, and a 17 defense, they are reliable infantry when they're done with their missiles. Do note they have an armor piercing melee attack, so I think they are like axes or something. Yes, they have these axes over here, which is really nice. And that is armor piercing. It didn't used to stay in the description that if their melee weapons were armor piercing, but in version 5 they added it, and I think it's a really good, useful addition towards description, because you do want to know what kind of melee weapon you're dealing with. They have very good morale, impetuous morale response. They have normal movement speed, which is actually pretty surprising. I think that has to do something with their history. I'm not sure. They do have a bonus against wargs. They have 24 missiles, 160 meter range, and an average accuracy, making them a direct upgrade of the Dwarven Travelers. So, if you have the opportunity, train these units always over trying to get some mercenaries, because they are really worth it. And then we also deal with the catapults, which is actually the same as the ballistae. The difference between a dwarven catapult and a normal catapult is a dwarven catapult is more accurate, and they have the grape shot possibility. So if you have this button over here, you see now you have flaming arrows, flaming ammunition. This button is the grape shot. So grape shot are very, very effective against infantry units, especially pretty close ranged. I don't think it changes the range of the catapult though, but close range it's more likely to hit things. And normal ammunition. So, 3 options instead of 2 for a normal catapult, for a non-dwarven catapult. They are like the replacement of the lack of archers the dwarves have. And that's a nice thing to touch upon. That these are the small things that really make a nation stand out, and I really like that. Then going to your elite tier units, and I've made a two tiers, but the difference between them is not that much. It's most of the time the role they play. So dealing with the first one, we have the Khazad-dûm Reclaimers, which is an axe throwing unit, and I think when they are done, they are also axes, I'm not sure. But they have a 9 melee attack, a 30 missile attack, which is armor piercing, and a 7 charge bonus, and a total defense of 27. Mostly in armor and no shields. I already said their axes are armor piercing. I don't think their normal weapons are armor piercing, or else it would have been listed over here. But I could be wrong about that. They have excellent morale, good morale response, a bonus against camels, wargs, horses and elephants. They have 2 axes with a 45 meter range, and they have a high accuracy. So they will hit what they're aiming for. Just a really, really good unit. I think you get one when you, once you have reclaimed Kazakh Doom, but I'm not sure. Then, the 1st Legion, the pike unit of Kazakh Doom, with an 8 attack, a 4 charge and a 25 defense. They are a really, really good pike unit, actually. They can really win the battles for you. And they use the pike animation, so most of the times you can triple the attack due to the animations. They inspire nearby troops, they're skilled against mounts, they have very long spears, which means they are not very likely to get in combat in melee. They have unwavering morale and it's locked, so they will not run away. They will fight to the last man. They have a good morale response and a bonus against camels, wargs, horses and elephants. Don't think any of your units is restricted, so that's nice. The reclaimers maybe. Yes. So the reclaimers can only be trained in Kazakh Doom. Which means, I think, both Kazakh Dooms, actually. Then we deal with another unit of the Orokhani of the Hall of the Seven. The Iron Fist Hammers. Since I have not included all units of the Hall of the Seven. Because they are partly in the Erebor video. And they will be in the Erelewin video. But I've chosen to take this one on. I could have involved the Blacklock Engineers, but I think they have already shined in the Erebor video, and they might also have been in the Khan video, but I'm not really sure about the latter. But Iron Fist Hammers, I just want to include it. Although these might also have been in the Khan video as well. But with an 11 attack, a 7 charge and a 28 defense, they are the strikers of your army. They are effective against armor, they have unwavering morale, which is locked. They have good morale response, just an all-around reliable, really, really good strike infantry. There's not much to say about them. They are just good strike infantry. And dealing with the second part of them, I could have switched these out for the Kazakh Doom Guardians, I think, now. Because all of these units are not native to Kazakh Doom, but the Guardians are. So let's deal with them first. Another sword and board unit with an 11 attack, a 5 charge and a 35 defense. They are really, really tanky. They have unwavering morale and it's locked. Good morale response and 10% penalty on movement speed. I don't think these guys are restricted. No, they are restricted as well to Kazakh Doom. So you have two units, the two Kazakh Doom units are restricted. Besides that, the Hittai Glaive might be restricted as well. No, they're not anymore. They used to be, if I remember well. They used to be restricted to the mountain, to the Misty Mountain area. But they're not restricted anymore. So, only two units are restricted from your mainstream roster. Because here we have another unit that is restricted to Gundabad. The Hammers of Gundabad. A very, very, very strong strike infantry. With a 15 attack, a 7 charge, and a 33 defense. They are the beast on the fields. They inspire nearby troops. They are the units that can use sharpened stakes, which is, as dwarves, pretty... I think it's pretty useful. They are effective against armor, frighten nearby enemies. If you have these guys on the field, you don't need to worry a thing, because you will win. They have unwavering morale and it's locked. And a good morale response. And a nice note, they have a bonus fighting against elephants. But overall, a really, really, really good unit. And you can only build them in Gundabad after you rebuild the Hall of the Awakening. Of Durin the First. And now I remember the name. It's Durin the First that is... And that first awakens in Gundabad, and therefore Gunnabad is such is kind of a sacred place for the dwarves. And then last, we have to deal with the Dragon Slayers. With a 10 attack, a 6 charge and a 30 defense, they are also some tanky units. They are effective against armor, skilled against mounts, frightened nearby enemies, inspire nearby troops. They are like a Hammers of Gunnabad Light. They don't have the same punch as the hammers, but they do have a lot of skills the hammers do have as well. They have unwavering morale, it's locked, and an impetuous morale response, so they deal really, really well with morale shocks. They have a bonus for fighting against camels, walks, horses, and elephants. And I think these guys are restricted to the Grey Mountains, yes. That is roughly from Gundabad towards Erebor. So Gundabad, Borsakul maybe, Wedabor probably, or Nazanar, but not Erebor itself. So that kind of area, you might get them in Rakjaberg, but I don't think you will. So there are only a few places you can train them. Then, at the back, we have two general units this time. I made the Balingsgard the captain, but let's deal... first deal with the Zenigard, because they are your regular bodyguard. They have a 10 attack, a 5 charge, and a 34 defense, making them as tanky as, for example, the Reclaimers, I think, yes. They're similar to the Guardians. Similar to the Guardians. There are less of them, and they have a locked morale. So the morale is unwavering and locked. Which means that your generals cannot run away. If you want to save a general, you need to win the battle and not get him killed. They have good morale response. There's something that went wrong here with the listing. Because normally it's morale response, and then movement speed. But something messed up here. But besides the lock morale, just a good, tanky... general's unit. Then we also have Balingsgard. They are quite similar, I think. Yes, they're quite similar. With a 9 attack, a 5 charge, and a 36 defense. The stats seem similar, but Balingsgard is armor piercing. Unlike the Zenith Guard. And they also inspire nearby troops. But do note also their morale is unwavering and locked. And yes, they are faster than your regular bodyguard. So that's a nice touch. There are a few small differences. But do note the Balin's Guard you cannot train. You get them by having Balin alive. And they are there. And because you can't train them, they don't have any upkeep. So you see the recruitment cost, which is most likely there for the retraining. But you don't have any upkeep because you can't train the Balingsgard. So that is Khazad-dûm's roster. There are some additions in them. Do mercenaries or... the Orkani Hall. But they are not included. So the units you will be able to train is a little bit more than this. But this is your roster. And the additions you get are optional. And not always there. For different reasons. So. Then. There's only one thing left for me to do. And that is hand everything over to the AI. Except for the siege equipment. I think I would like to deal with to show off some of the skills of the siege equipment. unpause the game. And let's see what we are up against. My army needs to reform. That is not in our advantage, of course. We already get some troops and some fire off with the Ballistae. We have, well, we already have arrows incoming. We see some green. I see some horses over there. More green. I see some gold and red in there. Seems some green banners while the Ballistae is firing away. But a lot of archers, so it can only be one thing actually. Some darker green. And we are dealing with the Woodland Realm. So next week we will see Tandril's Kin with the Elder Council, the Elven King's Axe Guard, the Bow Guard, we have some, and the Gate Guard. The Aretherith. Let's see how accurate the grape shot is. Not that accurate, actually. Right, and now it's over since men are in melee attack. I have to say, I've never seen any battle win with the army I fielded in an overview. So I really thought this would be a matchup since the dwarves are pretty tanky, but it seems like the lack of archer power is really getting to them. We do have some Lothlorien units in between, if I saw. Well, yes, and that is because of the script Lothlorien and the Woodland Realm share, so interesting to see how that turns out. Right, but for now, I will say goodbye. I hope to see you soon in another video of Divine and Conquer. But until then, have a nice day and see you next time.